Two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, 10.
You see another red.
Yes.
Wow.
Yeah.
They didn't send you. You didn't get the memo.
Congratulations on it.
We have a new member.
We will have a new member. Craig is the part of session. This is Craig's last.
So Craig has to sing the fight song.
Oh, I see.
We wanted to either vote against or abstain on them.
Well, five people walk out of the room.
You sort of follow all that?
Eric?
Yeah.
Can I ask you to play? Doors are all open, right?
session. We'll go back to our agenda. And the first item is fiscal 2016 year-end reserve fund transfer request. Bob.
Oh, yeah. On page 2 of your tonight's packet. There's three requests. The first is $50,000 for TLT litigation. And let me just see if I included a horrifically detailed spreadsheet that starts on page 6. If you look at the top of page 6, the legal budget has three pieces: town council, labor council, and then TLT litigation. Right now we're overdrawn in TLT litigation by about $31,000. You see that's in the thing that says actual. John and I estimate another $20,000. It shouldn't be that much, but it could be just based on last year's year-end stuff. So that's about a $50,000 shortfall. And just as a round number, that's where I'm requesting. You can see the other two pieces. Although we don't have June invoices, I'm sure there'll be a surplus between those two pieces put together of some amount. But $50,000 is certainly safe. And I have to say, I expect to turn $20,000 or $25,000 of that back. But you just never know. And obviously, if we don't have to spend it on legal, it doesn't go back to free cash. On page 3, you'll see a request from the fire department. On page 4, there's one from the library. Earlier this week, they each called me and said they don't think they need it anymore, but I'm going to go ahead and ask for it anyways, just because, again, it's going to free cash either through your fund or through their budget, and there's really no difference. In a case they've done something wrong, you know, in the last couple days of the year, it's less likely it'll be a library emergency, but you just never know with public safety in the last couple days of the year. Greg's situation, if you remember, this was the first year in quite some time he has not actually asked for money at April Town Meeting for overtime. So things have definitely improved. His injuries were pretty good up until you can see that list.
Has that retirement gone through?
That finally did go through, thank goodness. And that was taken off the books, if you will, at Town Meeting, so you know that did help. And then the library was, you know, no one knew that Ruth was going to retire at annual Town Meeting. So when she left with some extra vacation time, they had to pay it. They didn't think they'd have the money. So those are the three pieces.
So that everyone's clear, FinCom has a reserve fund of $150,000, and it's to be used for kind of in-between town meetings for needs. So this is the kind of item that comes up. And the reason we have the year-end meeting is precisely this, that sometimes the stuff that comes up at year-end that wasn't foreseen at April Town Meeting, and we would have the ability to authorize that. It reduces our balance down, in this case, from $150,000 to $84,500. That would be available till the next town meeting, or if something crazy happens, we have to figure out something else. But then at the next town meeting, it would get
replenished.
It would get replenished, but it goes to free cash at year end and then gets replenished to the next town meeting. So, questions, discussion on any of these three?
The next meeting is September?
Well, we're going to talk about that.
Oh. You were town meeting?
Town meeting.
September or November.
Okay.
Yep. Yeah, or November.
I'm just curious, yeah, what is our policy for rollover and vacation?
That is a good question. Let me try to explain it. I'm sorry John left. First of all the unions have contracts, so it's either stipulated in the contract or it defaults to something else, but in almost every case it's in a contract. I assume the same is true for the school unions. For non-union, my understanding is that the schools generally have employment agreements, maybe not in every single non-union, but the majority of them, and it's stipulated in an employment agreement. On the town, we have very few of those. We have between 1 and 3, and that's a legal question. I have one, and the two chiefs may have one, which is not sure. And then default, it's like a terms and conditions, it's one or two pages, terms and conditions of employment. And then for all the other non-union folks that are not covered either by employment, well, by the employment agreement, or the unions who don't have something written, default to the personnel policy. Our personnel policy specifies limitations and use it or lose it numbers. You know, you can carry at most one extra week beyond whatever is normally allowed. Well, if you have 3 weeks vacation, you can carry one extra week past a deadline.
Mm-hmm.
January 1st or July 1st. If you have 4 or 5 weeks, you can carry 2 extra weeks. Anything more than that, you lose. So that's the policy. Now, there is an employee committee looking at this, and there is ever-changing HR legislation. So we're trying to address our personnel policies in case they have some legal deficiencies, and I don't know that yet, as to whether it's lawful to take away earned time like that. I don't know. So we are looking at that issue.
I feel better if it was cleaner, because exposures like this, and,
yeah, and
it's pretty clear with companies. And
yeah, and again, just to differentiate, you've seen some transfers, especially through town meeting, of larger amounts. You know, 3 retirements, $40,000 or $50,000. That's not what we're talking about here. That's not vacation. That's sick leave. That could be vacation and sick leave.
Mm-hmm.
Sick leave was eliminated by every union and every non-union in the town side. I really don't know the schools. I'm just not sure. I think that out there too. But anyone who was grandfathered is still eligible when they retire to cash that in. So some long 30, 40-year-old outstanding employees do leave with sick leave buyback. And the rule there is whatever your rate of pay is when you retire, you get all your sick leave cut in half. So 50% value of all your sick days. With a maximum of 100 days. So 50 days.
That was a very limited number of people left, right?
Yeah.
Most people do.
Yeah,
I don't
it
know
is
the
a limited
exact
number.
But there are people that get it that are still here.
Yeah, and in
there
some unions
we've
negotiated that away. We bought them all out, so there's no, even though there's still employees here, they don't have it. I think that's true in at least 2 unions, maybe 3. But there are 15 or 20 employees left, something like that. So when someone like the library director leaves, that's not sick leave, that's vacation she never took that she is legally entitled to. So we have to pay it.
So I want to be clear, so we have a good policy so that financially we can be contained.
Yeah. Yeah, my preference, to the extent I have it, a choice, is to buy people out sooner than later. Because, first of all, it costs more later and there's more uncertainty. You know, at the end of a fiscal year, you know, if you have an extra $5,000 in your budget and someone wants to cash in time, I don't see a problem with that. Because it's going to cost you $7,000 by the time they get around to really cashing it in, you know, a year or 2 or 3 years in the future. So, you know, we'll see where the personnel policies go, but that's kind of my philosophy.
But people cash out their vacation every year?
No, no, no. Just, well, I would like them to have the option. They can when they leave, when they retire. But I don't see any harm in buying it out sooner if they want to. You're going to have to buy it either at today's rate of pay or at tomorrow's rate of pay, and today's rate of pay is low.
Right, but if you cap it so that they don't keep paying
well,
it over.
Well, if that's legal.
I can't imagine.
It's their earned time.
It's earned time.
But they're
the laws
choosing
are
not
changing
to take
quickly.
Vacation.
Well, I think some positions are so demanding that people struggle to take their time off, and
yeah.
They shouldn't be penalized for that.
Employment law is very much changing in face of the employee, in favor of the employee. Because as Sharon says, there's in some institutions an implicit demand that you not use it because you better stay here or you'll be fired. Now, we don't do that here.
No.
And we really can't, but in the private sector, you know, there's some employees, you know, that really are not being treated equitably, I guess I'd say. So
it's
we'll
not
we'll
like
hash all
back up too. When you take vacation, you're working twice as hard to make it up, you know, if you're one of these positions where these things have to get done. So sometimes it's easier not to take the vacation.
That's
for
sure.
But we all convince ourselves we're indispensable.
Exactly, but I do feel like there are definitely the same host of people.
Yeah, nobody does her job when she's not here.
Yeah, but I still take my vacation.
Good
for
you.
You should.
But I have somebody who works for me every year who is in danger of losing time every year.
Yeah.
And it's awful because she just doesn't take the time off because she has to work twice as hard because of it.
And, you know, we have employees in the building, and I'm sure there's some in the schools that will take a vacation day on Thursday and then come in for free on Friday and Saturday.
Yes, exactly. Or when I go
that
on vacation,
didn't lose
I take
the time.
My computer and I'm still doing minimal stuff to keep
that up.
You know what I mean? So that's the sort of thing that the trade-off so that you don't come back to this nightmare that you can't recover from. So.
Yep. Okay. We can
any other comments on this video? I would entertain a motion.
So moved.
Probably have to be a little more explicit.
Motion to approve the transfer of $65,000 as... $65,500 as noted in the handout.
So have a second?
Second.
Mark. Any other comments, questions? No? All those in favor? Opposed? 800.
So I will sign this June 29th, the amount of $65,500. We won't be approved by tomorrow.
Exactly, because I've got some of your legal bills ready for that one.
There's one, you want one more?
I'll keep one.
Thank you. All right, next item, proposed fund balance policy, Sharon.
A couple of years ago, our auditors had asked us to produce a fund balance policy, and specifically they wanted us to address the different types of fund balance that came into play when GASB 54 was passed, which was several years ago. And back then, I think the town accountant at the time and the auditors kind of determined what would be in these different categories, because prior to that, it was designated fund balance or undesignated, and they were designated for specific purposes. This GASB 54 was to help the reader of the financial statements understand a little bit better what is in fund balance. And so they were supposed to make it a little more clear for somebody who doesn't really know that there are portions of our fund balance that might be non-spendable form. And so they wanted that addressed. They also thought it would be nice to address the order of which we spend funds, like particularly for a project, if we've got multiple sources of funding, say a grant and free cash, what is the order of which we spend that? In case there's money left over, where does it go? Do we go send it back to the grant? And it's always been our policy to go with the most restricted, the restricted funds first, and then, you know, follow suit depending on whatever different types of funds are available for a project. So that would be a grant before we use free cash, for instance. So that was the other thing they wanted to address as part of the fund balance. But then the final thing was to address what we consider a minimum level of reserves or fund balance. And we do have that 5% FinCom policy, but they wanted a document that was all-encompassing, kind of addressing that. And there had been some discussion about potentially increasing that 5%, as we had learned that bond rating agencies really like to see 7 or 8. So I drafted this document to address all of those concerns by the auditor and threw in a 7% fund balance minimum with a 5% as a, you know, a baseline, but a cause for concern, a cause for a reaction if we actually fell below the 7. But that's up for discussion. This had been presented to Board Selectmen, but they did want FinCom to hear it and to give their comment on it before they would have passed it. The Board of Selectmen was going to pass this policy per the auditor's request. They said Board of Selectmen needs to acknowledge and accept and approve this policy. So that is the reason for the policy. I'll go over quickly what some of this means. So, for instance, the 5 different categories of fund balance are non-spendable, restricted, committed, assigned, and unassigned. The non-spendable, it tends to be fund balance that's in a non-spendable form.
Can you give us an example as you go through those?
Yeah, I'm going to give examples.
Okay.
So a non-spendable form of fund balance would be inventory or perm funds. A permanent fund is something that we can't spend. So for instance, if somebody bequests us money for a scholarship and they said, here's the money, you can only spend the interest. That's in a non-spendable form. So it's not able to be used towards anything. It's just going to sit there and earn interest. So to know that that money is non-spendable is very helpful for the financial statement reader to know, yeah, this money is in fund balance, but it's in a non-spendable form. And then restricted is basically when a third party restricts how those funds can be used. Those are usually grants, because the grants usually tell you what they'll let you use the money for. And then revolving funds, like school revolving funds, there's laws governing what you can use those revolving funds for. So a third party, somebody outside the organization that actually dictates what those funds can be used for, would fall under restricted, and that's mostly grants and revolving funds. Committed is funds that have been approved by the highest authority of the town, which would be town meeting. So if an article passes at town meeting, it would probably end up in this committed fund balance, meaning we've committed to do this as a body. And if we wanted to reverse that, you have to go back to town meeting to reverse it. You know, nobody can just decide at town hall, no, we're not gonna do that. If we ask town meeting to do it and we decide not to do it, we have to go back to rescind. So committed is something that would be passed specifically by town meeting. And assigned is basically a intent. It's basically somebody who's been designated for town by town hall, whether it be Bob or one of his designees, has put in an encumbrance or intent to use money for something like a PO. Like, so at year end, we have tons of these. Say we order from WB Mason, we put a requisition in, we have a PO, they call it an encumbrance, and they bring the money forward to the next year because the funds were for fiscal 16, and they're going to fiscal 17 so that we can pay for that bill when the items come in. So an encumbrance is an example. And also, when we vote to use free cash at town meeting for the next year, that would sit in an assigned balance as well. And then anything that doesn't fit into any one of those categories is unassigned and is free to be used for whatever. So a lot of times when financial statement readers are looking at our financials, unassigned is the balance they go to, because that really tells them how much is free to be used for, you know, whatever comes up. And so that number is probably the largest number that the bond rating agencies is looking at, is that's what's free to be spent. So that gives a little bit more clarity to what fund balance is made up of, and that's why that GASB 54 went into play. And our financial statements definitely state it, but I think they wanted a policy that clarifies that the auditors just didn't arbitrarily pick them, that we have a policy that dictates how these different types of fund balance are assigned to these different categories. Because that discussion did happen, but it's not on paper, so that they could say, well, somebody could say, well, the auditors just decided. There was definitely a discussion that took place about how do these things fall in line with this. And legally, there's really some that aren't any wiggle room. Non-spendable, you can't just throw anything there. But assigned and committed, that was a little bit of a harder one, you know. So, but decisions were made about what we believe belongs in those categories, and they wanted a policy in place that we could refer to and say it falls in line with what we do on our financial statements. So it's really just so that they have something to point to and says, this is the town policy, and that's why we put it where we do on financial statements when we audit. And then, of course, the order of which we spend money for projects. If you're looking at our financial statements, you might assume that maybe the auditors decide what that is. It really is a policy that's internal, but they wanted it on an accepted policy that kind of acknowledges we use the most restrictive funds first when a project has multiple funding sources. So that,
and it might say here, but so unassigned, that would be, of course, certified free cash, but would that
be part of free cash? Free cash isn't always what the unassigned balance is, because what happens, DOR kind of makes some adjustments. So say we have a revolving fund that ends with like a deficit because maybe something happened that they didn't claim for, maybe they spent more. If something ends in a deficit, it gets deducted from the fund balance.
Mm-hmm.
So you it's not one for one. When you see unassigned, it doesn't necessarily mean free cash. Because they do make adjustments for things like, for instance, a revolving fund I can point to that would be very familiar to you is police detail. People work overtime on a police detail, and we bill it out to the company that ordered that detail. They're getting paid before we actually get the money, and so almost always we end the year on a deficit. They're not going to let you say that you have whatever's in your unassigned when they know that there's money that's in a deficit in another fund. They take everything from the general fund, and they net it out. So that's one example. A detail is frequently one of the things that's being deducted. It's because it's in a deficit at the end of every year because we pay our people before we get our money. And so to say unassigned is free cash, it's similar,
but
there's adjustments being made. Exactly.
And it's not necessarily, in terms of definition, it doesn't matter necessarily in this question mark, that let's say, you know, when we had the sale of real estate fund that took, it was more restrictive taking money out of that. That doesn't come into play. That's not part of the definition.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. It's really function, not how hard it is to get.
Yes, exactly.
Okay. I got it.
And so all these things have kind of always been in, like when GASB 54 came into play, we kind of already made these decisions. They just wanted a written policy
mm-hmm.
that addresses
mm-hmm.
that this is how we acknowledge these categories and what falls into them. And and how we spend our cash in terms of the order. And then that policy about the reserve, we do have that 5% minimum reserve policy that's a FinCom policy. Based on some of our conversations, I believe that we had talked about potentially moving it up, and so I put in the 7% with the 5% kind of as a cause for concern. If we deliberately went under the 7 for a specific circumstance, that at 5%, that would be where we would start trying to do things to build it back up. So that's essentially what I put in there, but it could be changed because it's in draft format.
Mm-hmm.
Board of Selectmen has heard and seen this fund balance policy, but wanted it to be run by FinCom for comment before they would approve it. So that's where we're at.
If you look at page 20 just for a moment in the packet, I looked at a few other towns just to see what they share publicly in terms of what their policies are. And it wasn't available for everybody, but Winchester has a goal of 10 with a minimum of 6. Lexington shows a goal of 7. I couldn't find anything for North Reading. Stoneham shows a goal of 10. I couldn't find anything for Wakefield. Dedham showed a range of, they want to keep it between 5 and 10% with a minimum of 5. And Linfield, I couldn't find either. Yeah, I don't know if folks had seen any others, but these.
It's really hard sometimes to get this data when you put it on another list, because you don't get your peer communities, you get communities that we don't, that aren't relatable necessarily. They don't always respond very quickly.
I'm sorry.
Just a quick kind of comment and question on the way the levels and the percentages are presented here. I definitely like having the two saying, okay, we have a goal and it looks like some other towns are doing that. The way that it's written here, what, if any, are the consequences of going below 5%? And I assume nothing on the 7,
no,
because the way it's written is that's a goal.
It's us regulating ourselves. It's
yep.
An internal policy. But, you know, we're basically saying if we fall below 5, we're going to take action to try and rebuild
yep.
back up. That we are not going to just let it diminish down to nothing. That we have an intent
mm-hmm.
to be at 5% or higher. Ideally 7 or higher is really
yeah.
what we're saying. But that circumstances such as this litigation might be a reason for us to say, okay, we're willing to forego the 7 and maybe go to a baseline 5, you know, but it gives us
more
flexibility.
Do the rating agencies care about having the two numbers, or do they just look and say,
yeah.
ultimately, you're saying 5?
What do you got is all they care about.
Fair enough. All right.
It's a moral
obligation.
They don't really care what your policy, they like that you have a policy,
okay.
but they're really looking at what are you holding.
Yeah.
So.
Makes sense.
So there's no downside to a low or minimum?
Externally.
Externally, yes.
I don't know if they really are as interested in our policy as what we have.
Yeah. For
the
rating
I think it's more
yeah.
rating agencies are really interested in when they look at your financial statements, what is your percentage of reserves, not
mm-hmm.
what your policy is. They like to see that you have a policy, that you have a plan, that you've thought this through. Obviously, I think it's the higher the number, that's show of a discipline, that you are
sure.
not willing to go below a certain number. I mean, I think it does factor in, but what speaks louder to them is how high
show
do you keep your reserves?
Yeah.
Where are they and
exactly.
how much is
sure.
it?
And who did you say in the beginning of 1 and 8%? You said someone...
Bond rating agencies like to see 8
like
to 10.
Okay, but that's not, it's not policy.
No, that's
they,
not
that's
a policy.
Just
the
ballpark
it's just something that
like
we've come to realize in talking to some of these folks that they, it seems like you're more in their favor if you're in that range or higher.
Okay.
And some are higher. I mean,
yeah,
some communities are.
Some communities are above 10.
Yeah.
If there really isn't, you know, a consequence to going below
mm-hmm.
what we have in there, and we've got a data point that suggests they like to see,
mm-hmm.
you know, in the range of 8 to 10, should that 7 be 8? Should that 7 be 10?
That's a discussion point. I mean, I just kind of started
right.
the
yeah.
conversation with the 7.
But I guess conversely, if we are breaking a policy, isn't that more of a more concrete evidence to say that we're not meeting our goals?
I think that when you do, yeah, it is true, yeah. That would be a concern. But if you do make the decision for a justifiable reason and you document your decision making that led to that decision, I think that that's taken into consideration too.
Okay.
And remember, this policy here is for the auditors.
They just want to
Good point.
Yeah, I don't know what that means.
Yeah, I think we
I think
have
to make sure
maybe.
That the visual of it makes sense also.
Yeah.
You know, we regularly at town meeting discuss this as a minimum target and something that we monitor and we do. And graphs always kind of take a look and say, hey, that's the number it's got to be at minimum.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's interesting looking at that Dedham where they say our goal is 5 to 10%, but our minimum is 5. I'd be a little hesitant to go too high with people kind of looking at it and say, well, you know, you said 8 and you're at 7. So, you know, that means you got to change policies, guys.
I kind of like that whole concept of
a band.
Of the band, because again, you know, no one can ding you for it.
You're saying 5 to 10%.
Like 5 to 10, and then hopefully
if you're in
that
range.
Yeah, I think that's.
How often are we
great.
In the 10% range?
It happened for the last 2 years.
Yeah.
Do we want an upper limit on our range?
Yeah.
Right. That's the only part I don't like about the range.
Yeah.
Is suggesting. Okay, if we go to the town, you know, and once you get some traction behind this and we say our range is between this and this, well, anytime we start floating above the range, we may have good reason for doing that, but
someone's gonna say
things like an override aren't going to happen if you are anywhere above that range.
Good point.
So I do like the, hey, we have a minimum that's going to set the alarm bells off. But we have a target of a certain number. It.
So you're saying maybe make the target a little higher.
And make the target a little bit
like
higher because maybe you're playing around with words somewhat, but you're not saying, hey, we're trying to keep the balance in here. We're trying to get a target of at least 7%, at least 8%, whatever the number might be.
Is there anything that the auditors do want like that doesn't sort of pass muster? Like would a large range or larger range. Now I'm not saying
10%. I think they just
want
it
written on paper.
They just want it on paper.
Fine.
Most auditors, you do what you say. You know, say what you do and do what you
say.
You know,
see how are we managing.
We should
have
our
goals
when
we're sitting down
and
making decisions. Are we considering a minimum reserve? And they just want us to put to paper what we execute. Really, is you know what are we thinking when we make these decisions? What are we trying to maintain when we decide to use $2 million of free cash? Are we worried about that minimum? And that's, I think, what they're looking to see is how we execute our decisions and what is the basis for some of those decisions.
I think our policy has been, yes, we're very worried about it. We're very concerned that we keep it in mind. But because we've been above that 5, we felt a little bit better about it the last few years. The ability to, number one, regenerate funds, and number two, allow some of that to help the operating budget. And had we not done that, the operating budget would have suffered quite a bit the last 2 years.
But we have such a conservative budgeting style. We perform well. We seem to regenerate what we use. So it almost looks to an outsider like we didn't use any free cash because
right.
we regenerate
right.
what
it's
we
like
use.
It's like just a
yeah.
buffer.
Right.
So
it
it's been working
it
for
it
us.
It does until it doesn't.
Right.
And
then,
now
and
as...
And that's the
right,
thing.
Well, that's the problem. But that becomes the problem
that.
Is now with things growing, you know, health insurance costs being, you know, a great example, as those numbers are getting bigger, we haven't had a miss, but the time will come when we have a miss,
sure.
and with each year we don't have it, when that miss comes, it's going to be bigger.
Exactly.
It's we're pushing it down, it's going to have it, and so 5% 5 years ago isn't, you know, isn't realistic anymore, and I don't think anyone's suggesting we keep it at 5, but it, you know, that's the part that worries me, is
how do people,
a miss is going to be big.
How do people feel 7 versus 8, for example?
Is the high range, you're saying?
As a target number.
I would keep 7. I actually prefer a range 7 to 10 for a reason. The counter argument is that it gives you more flexibility to change year to year and not having to explain yourself all the time. But having a, knowing that, hey, we're never going to go above 10, for example, something to that point. Or at some point when you see that as time changes and, you know, what you just said, hey, 5% 5 years ago might be good, it's no longer than 5 years from now, you change. There's nothing wrong changing the range at some point, you know, 10 years from now, 5 years from now. So, but 7 to 10 would be my...
Other comments?
I like the 5 to 10, because again, this is the policy for the auditors.
Yeah.
We can then have a slightly different policy within that range, right?
Practice or whatever, yeah.
But you don't wanna feel like you're having to change your major policy every time, so I'd like a bigger band.
I agree with Paul, I think 5 to 10.
Yeah, you're thinking about it.
Okay, so when you're saying the 5 to 10, that would be that as opposed to the 7, but keeping the less than 5% as cause for concern, but not necessarily above 10% being cause for concern. I would have cause for concern if we put something in place that suggested above a certain amount suggesting cause for concern.
Mm.
That's a good thing.
Cause for celebration?
Yeah.
Right,
not
right.
Concern.
I would say no because it's not a designated purpose.
So let me throw this thought out there. Reading is a little unusual that we don't have a capital stabilization fund, and many communities do. If you put money into a capital stabilization fund, it doesn't count against what you're talking about. It's not part of that 5 or 7 or 10% figure. And again, I think North Reading has one. I mean, there's a lot of communities that have anywhere from $1 million to $8 or $10 million.
Mm-hmm.
And it's meant for capital planning purposes where perhaps the capital need hasn't been identified yet and it suddenly appears. And it gives them more flexibility to do a larger project inside the levy. So for instance, Killam, we've talked about in the past, it was $3 to $5 million. It's back on the drawing board, but in theory, if you had a capital stabilization fund, you don't have to ask for a debt exclusion or capital exclusion.
So you say for an unidentified, so you, in theory, would build it up over time.
You could, yep.
For...
And then you have to go to town meeting and I assume get a 2/3 vote to get it
to
out, but it's just another way to save money that, you know, some of it's optics. It doesn't appear as free cash, but it's real. It's not available for that. It's for another purpose. And it's kind of like sale of real estate, the way we've treated sale of real estate, because we've put it towards capital over 10 or 12 years.
So then you're saying that wouldn't be part of this?
Right.
And
so you can always get rid of the problem
excess
of having
10%. Oh, okay.
Right, right.
Okay. I'm not worried about that problem.
You start
okay.
topping
yeah,
it up.
I'm
not
sure
about
we're
going
to have that problem.
Because of the ability to move, I would actually be more in favor of an 8% upper limit, and you know, if we want to hold, if we have 10% and we want to hold back a little for some particular reason, but you know, I mean, if we've got more than 8%, what is that there for? I mean, it's going to get spent. Do you want to say 10% is the right level before you start feeling you need to do something with it, and putting it in a reserve for pulling out of free cash and putting in a reserve for some future costs, you know, 10% is almost a month spent.
It's a big number. And it's also telling everyone,
but
when we have 8%, your policy
so
says 10, what are you going to do about it? The lower number says we must do something. Anything below the upper number says you should. So be careful on that upper number, because it is saying if you're below it, you're going to do something. Well, you don't have to do something, you should. Because you've set a policy that's here.
Yeah,
and
that's
there.
To me, the 5 to 8, if you have an unusual item come up at some point and you say, well, we've got to go down and we'll try to regenerate it or find it some other way, you can justify going down a little bit. But 10% for just free cash seems a little high to me for a goal.
But the problem is then we've been operating out of our policy for years. That's my concern.
No, you haven't. You've had 5 minutes.
We've been 10% for 2 years, you said.
But you haven't yet had a policy.
We didn't accept this
right,
policy.
But I'm saying in theory,
yeah,
for those numbers, we would have been.
I think you're misunderstanding the top level. The top level is your target. If you have more, that's okay.
Yeah.
Right, yeah.
It doesn't matter.
We're targeting to try
and
but
if you're below the top of the target, the top number, you're supposed to be at the top
readjusting.
Number.
Yeah.
You should be making some effort. When you get to the emergency low number, then you must.
I think you got to look at the top number as your what our new
that's your
minimum
default.
Is. And I think the way that I took it from the auditor, I said, what if we put this in place and we need to go below it? And that's why he suggested the because you need to have a point of which you have some reaction to it to try and rebuild back to your goal. And your goal is 7 or 8% for instance. We got to look at that like that's our minimum. But there are gonna be circumstances where we are going to go away from our policy, like say this litigation could be a reason to let us fall below, say like a 7 or 8%. And we have reason for it. We document our reason for our decision. Just like our reason to go down on the capital from 5% to 4.75, we make a justifiable decision based on budget constraint. We've decided to go against this set policy for a justifiable reason that we think is reasonable. As long as we're documenting our decisions and that we are, you know, trying to get back to that number, I think that's what they're looking to see, is where are we aiming to be at a minimum. And the 8% or the 7% is gotta be looked at almost like our new minimum. Even though we're saying 5%, is if we fall below 5, we're really gonna be concerned and we're gonna be taking a lot of action to get back.
Can we, that's where I like, why I like the 5-10, because if we're now thinking maybe 7-8 is the right amount.
I think you should forget
should
the lower number. You might vote one, but just
number.
Don't think about it. Think about what you want as a target. And mm-hmm. that should be the upper number.
Because if we
say
that, I'm sorry.
If you want 10, that's fine, but that's what you're saying. I want 10.
See, I was saying I want the average. Okay.
No.
I see what you're saying.
Yeah.
The language is a little confusing to me. The equal to 7% or whatever number, that's, does that mean, are really, are we, what this is trying to say, equal to at least?
Yeah,
is
it should be
amount?
At least.
Yeah.
I think that we had had that suggestion by Court of Selectmen. At least 7%.
Okay.
And I like it, can I jump it back? I do like the way, if we add in the at least and debate over what the number, 7, 8, 10, whatever the number is, put the wording there, because again, we can, in practice, if it gets to 10%, we can do anything with it, but why put an upper restriction on us, right? What benefit do we get out of it, right? I mean, if we think we have a number, I don't see the benefit to an upper range. There might be one. I'm not seeing it right now, and the only thing I am seeing is potential downfall where we have reason to not use some of our cash, yet the town is going to come back to us and say, "Hey, you got a range of, you know, 5 to 10, and you're just over 10, so don't come asking me for any more money." And it's someday we may want to do that.
When I put this together, I was thinking of our 5% minimum is going to 7, and then if we had to bend from that new minimum of 7, that if we got down to 5, we would be taking some.
Right, we're not going below.
Action.
We're not going below 5 unless
we
really have to.
Yeah. You know, to get back to that 7 is.
It's not
possible.
A range. It's
it's really kind of saying
we're sort of stating
on a minimum
seven.
Of 7.
Yes.
And if we had to make a decision that forced us to go below that, if we hit 5, we would be taking some very aggressive action to get back.
Mm-hmm. I like
you,
that frame.
None of you were on FinCom when it went to 0.5%, so. This is a much better discussion.
Wow.
Yeah.
0.5%? Really?
The year we
did
60,000 of capital.
Oh, gosh.
If it's going to be an at least, I think I might be in favor of 7 rather than 8. I think the 8, 9, 10s are exceptions of the last 2 to 3 years. It's more than we've seen. And if we want to get it up as 8 as the minimum, that is going to impact the operating budget. That just means less money for it.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm not sure that that's the right consequence to, you know, just to say that we, you know, we've satisfied them by an extra 0.5%. I might suggest 7 would be the at least.
I know we've been high the last couple of years, but could you give me and I apologize if I was out of the room when you did this, like a little bit more history of, you know, the last 10 years, what was the range?
My recollection is, except for the last 2 years, it's been a high of like 8.5.
Since I've been here, it's been like 9 or higher, so that's been 4 years.
Oh, you're counting the stabilization fund.
Oh, yeah.
I never do that, so yeah, 9.
When I do the presentations for Finance Forum, I take the stabilization because it really is looked at, because it's a general stabilization. It doesn't have a specific designation, so when DOR looks at it, they're looking at that as almost like.
So it's been
7.5 to 9
in the last 5 years.
Okay.
Roughly.
Thank you.
But it was just barely 5%, not long ago,
mm-hmm.
in the fives, five
okay.
and a half, six.
Not that long ago,
like
10 years ago.
But it's been steady climbing.
Yeah.
Since you've been here, anyway.
Yeah, in the last 2 years, we've definitely had discussions about is 5 the appropriate level.
Right.
In light of the current budget, I mean, 7% sounds fine. If there is an override that comes down the road, we might want to revisit it and see whether
Well, again, don't look at this as an upper limit.
Yeah.
Right,
it's
exactly.
A minimum.
Minimum, yeah.
Yeah. I think
you gotta look
you
at
have
like
two minimums.
New minimum. Yeah.
Right.
But because it's an internal policy, just like the 5% of capital, you can bend a little for, you know, constrained budgets and say our goal is 5, but we will go down to 4.75 to make this budget work this year, or maybe for 2 years, but we're going back to our 5%. You know, so it's us regulating ourselves. There's no way, we're not going to be punished for veering a little bit away from what our intent was.
Bob, is our goal to kind of vote on a number to go in here and to change the FinCom policy and then have that affect the
this doesn't have to affect your policy. It could. Really, the selectman just requested, I'd say as a courtesy, I think it was a little more than that, to make sure you saw it before they voted. That didn't seem reasonable for them to just vote on it. And I think they were interested in what you thought of the numbers. And I would assume if you guys pick numbers, they'll just agree with it. I don't see why they wouldn't.
Yeah.
Right.
I think they're more interested in your feedback on what that percentage should be.
I would think if we pick numbers, I mean, that should be the... That should be us changing our policy as well. I'd feel disingenuous saying 7 is the number. All right.
Our policy is 5.
That's
yeah,
exactly.
I'm
that
seems
good.
So I would be in favor of the way it's written with the at least in front of the 7%.
Do you have a pen I can borrow? Mine ended up way down there somewhere.
Oh, maybe I want to push for a higher number than 7. Lower?
Oh, Gene might have taken your pen.
No,
it was
my
like
pen,
7.
Yeah. I'm like, what happened to all my paper? Oh, is that it?
Yeah. So should we, in that case, let's have a motion to adjust the FinCom reserve policy up from 5% to 7%.
Well, should we make that independent of this? I mean, I know we're talking about Lingam, but...
Well, you don't have to
vote
on
right
you
now?
Don't have to vote on this. You can't. You don't have any authority to pass this. The selectmen have to.
Just,
I think by adjusting the 7 and suggesting a 7, that does the job.
I think what the Board of Selectmen is looking for is feedback from FinCom as to what you think that number should be, because they want guidance. And this policy, the auditors have asked the Board of Selectmen to pass it. But it does make sense that it matches your policy regarding reserves. You know, that seems reasonable to me anyway.
It would be helpful, I think, to see the written proposal for an adjustment to the FinCom policy. Is that in here?
It's not here, but
it's just all you do is changing the number from 5 to 7. I don't remember the exact language. We could find it on the
does it
website.
Have this, it's the
oh,
same
you mean the
kind
actual
of construct
policy?
In terms of
that. Pulled
it
out for the debt offering. I can just grab it.
Yeah, could you?
Yes, please.
I know, and then we could just review, and I know we've seen it 100 times, but free cash versus stabilization funds.
What the balances are in each.
Yeah, and whether we distribute it the way we think it should be. Because I don't think it's just about what that percentage is.
Right.
Do we put it in the right funds?
No, we don't. Because the stabilization fund is there because of accident. You know, the
right.
The
and
legend
be using
is
that strategically.
The first year of the override, some money was put in there and left in there and has never been thought of since.
Mm-hmm.
That's the story I heard within the last 6 months.
Yeah, because
I
feel like we
that.
Could use them more strategically. If you have that 5% borrowing, should that be in a more restrictive account?
Yeah, I think that's a really good discussion to have. Because it is more restrictive. You need 2/3 instead of majority.
Exactly.
So that by itself is more restrictive,
mm-hmm.
plus the auditors look at it that way. The rating agencies look at it about the same. It doesn't really matter.
Mm-hmm.
As long as it can come out by vote of town.
That's
a good
better
point.
Discipline too.
Yeah. Yeah, and it changes the discussion. Well, depends how you want to have it, because free cash is then a lower number, but cash reserves,
mm-hmm.
which include a stabilization fund, is the same.
But it also creates
goes.
A policy arranger funds.
Yeah, that's a good idea.
Is that something we want to do in conjunction with this change, or as kind of a topic for next meeting?
I was gonna say if you'd rather have all that in writing for your next meeting. You can just give Sharon the indication that 7 is good, and she can just take it to the board. Whatever you want to do is fine. But
well, I think from nodding of heads, tell me if I'm wrong, I think people are in agreement 7 would be the recommendation back to the selectmen.
Yes.
Okay.
Well, for the policy.
For their policy.
Yeah.
And I think we should change ours, whether we change it right now or not.
Yeah.
Maybe we don't have to do that, but I think we should change it, if not today, then the next meeting.
Yeah, if you want to have that stabilization discussion, wait on that.
Have some numbers.
Yeah. tell Sharon she didn't have to leave when she gets back.
Okay, so that being the case, why don't we roll on?
All right, I'll go over the debt sale on page 12. I think the interesting column is the yield column. So for November upcoming, that's a bunch of different things in there, but that's $100,000 for the lighting project that we effectively canceled. We did spend, actually it wasn't $100,000, $50,000, good heavens. So the interest rates range from 0.4 to 1.65%, which is pretty amazing. So the longer debt is water debt, that's out at 1.6. We decided to defer the discussion for the next meeting, other than it's 5 to 7 is good.
We like your policy, though. No, go for it.
This is like a three-page FinCom policy. It addresses capital and reserves.
Yeah, so I think we'll the next meeting,
so
we're going to take up both that specifically.
That's what we'll give you guys.
Great, thanks. We'll do that, and we'll also talk about the how the stabilization fund exists, what it's used for, what its size should be, et cetera. But we want to give direction. Feedback to the selectmen that so we think 7 is the
number,
and our intention is to change our policy
Matt.
At the next meeting. Yeah.
On page 13, you can see there were 6 bidders, I think. Six. And the first 4 are almost identical, which tells you that those are strong bidders. Mm-hmm. That is the market. It's not one guy standing way out and just buying them. On page 15, I just included the S&P write up because that's something you should all be familiar with, certainly. I do want to go over a couple things that they highlighted, which Sharon and I found interesting. On page 16, Reading has a very rapid amortization of debt, which means we have a short debt schedule, 96.6% less than 10 years. And from my recollection, everything that's longer than 10 years is not in the general fund. That's water. I don't even think it's excluded debt anymore. It's all water. So that's a really good thing. You know, they really like that. But later down below, they say under strong management, they downgraded our something from very strong to strong, because while we have very good practice, we don't have a policy that says that's what we'll do, which drives me crazy.
So like this,
and they've never ever mentioned a written policy on this ever. So they've come up with a new idea that you should have a policy in writing, and we're going to downgrade you for that, even though you're one of the best issuers in Massachusetts on what you do. So that's why I don't really care what rating say. But by and large, you know, they're really happy.
That's excellent.
Yeah. You'll see the strengths and weaknesses. Some of it is our location and our economy, certainly, and some of it is things we actually do. It's pretty good.
So what do you do? Go with the previous report and sit there and go back and forth? Like how do you, what do you mean? When you were talking about downgrading, you know, like the words.
I don't know what they do.
Because you were talking about the words, this one went from very good to
the
good.
The question I asked, and she wouldn't answer. I can't remember
exactly.
What the
trend was for...
I asked kind of a simple, basic question.
For borrowing,
I thought,
was it?
I can't remember. It was kind of an innocuous-sounding question, I thought. I really wasn't trying to trick her.
No, you asked her if stabilization...
Oh,
like moving
counts the same.
Stabilization hurts, or, you know, is it viewed the same as having...
She wouldn't answer. That's an internal methodology I can't tell you. Hello?
Careful about how we change that.
So, you know, having a discussion with ratings, I will say the woman that wrote this up, this is as professional a write-up as I've seen in Reading. It's really well done. I don't necessarily agree with everything she said, but it's really well done and very thoughtful.
Right, and it was very specific.
Yes.
Yeah.
It really was good. If I were an investor, I would really appreciate having something like this. None of them read it anyways, though. But we did get off a good debt sale, and I'm sure you saw that we saved, you know, $480,000 for the NWRA buy-in. So we were looking at $1.5 million left of interest to pay on the buy-in, and now it's $1 million, roughly. So that's
very
a big
well
savings.
Done.
You know, over a long period of time, you know, $50,000 a year, who really cares? It's not a lot of money, but still, it's $500,000. It's not bad. You know, and I still remember the last time we did a big refunding or advance refunding. We saved $3.5 million on the high school.
Yeah.
And that's
big
not
big.
Something that a lot of people paid attention
big.
To. So, you know, that's money the taxpayers did not spend. We didn't get to use it for something else. They just did not spend it. And that was a good deal. And again, spread out over 15 years, it doesn't jump out at you. But that's that's not bad.
I don't think we really said a lot about it until the.
No, we, you know, we put it out there as a press release or whatever. Went on to the next thing. But this is probably our last refunding, I would say. First of all, you can only refund stuff that's longer than 10 years. So since we don't issue much longer than 10 years, we won't be doing it. And we've pretty much squeezed everything we can out of the interest rate market. So that's all on our debt situation. I think you're down in the listening session, right?
Almost. One more thing on page 18 of your thing, too. They do highlight OPEB.
Oh, okay.
They show that on every city and town.
Yeah. So we did ask the auditors about that. I remember at the auditors meeting, and they said, yeah, that's everybody's problem. But
we do better than most.
Exactly. We do better than most.
I mean, they'd be remiss not to mention if it's like a $63 million
right.
liability. You have to mention that that's kind of a weakness, because
right.
that's drawing on your funds for years to come. They kind of need to kind of
right.
highlight that.
And it has to be on our statements now. Clearly laid out. So that's the other thing we learned in the audit. That's the new rule. You got to show that OPEB liability kind of, you know, right up front. The last paragraph, though, on that, or the about the middle of the page, says currently we believe the town's pension and OPEB costs are manageable. However, due to the county retirement system's below average funded ratio, we believe this will likely remain a growing challenge. So,
what is the county
right,
the
it just
trend around us.
Yeah, it's
a lot of people around them that aren't behaving, so they might not either.
Yeah.
Did you notice under the outlook they talked about they don't expect to change our rating over the next 2 years, but they would consider it if
yeah.
our performance against budget were to decline and our reserve balance were to go down significantly. Kind of a caution to you that we
yeah.
expect you
yeah,
to kind of continue
that.
To operate the way you've seen.
Yeah, in terms of the OPEB, Sharon and I have talked about this a little, and I've talked on it a little bit with John. We still have not had any discussion on a dollar figure for the override, just to be clear. We're working kind of in a different way at it. That'll come in the next month for sure. But I would like to at least throw on the table for the selectmen to consider putting more towards this area on an annual basis. And it makes more sense to throw it at the pension fund. Defease that faster, because we can invest it more aggressively, for better or worse. So whatever we're doing now, 4.5% a year in pension, you know, we could increase that annual contribution, and we have a 2000 is a 29.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we could bring that in a couple of years and get to OPEB then a couple of years sooner. It seems like that's a reasonable thing to do, and you know, I'm not sure I'm talking a lot of money. It might only be $100,000 or $200,000, but it seems like that should be part of a package deal to me. If we're doing some kind of complete package, it seems reasonable that we should do that. Because 2029 is okay, but it's not good. There are towns that are shorter, even around us, that are getting their pension
faster. They said Boston was 2025?
Oh, that hurts.
Boston.
That's
worse, yeah. What is the Reading Retirement System? I thought we were part of the Bass Pension Retirement.
They invest through a collaborative, but they are independent board.
Okay.
Down on Haven Street. There's five board members, one's in the room.
Me.
And two employees, I guess.
And I think that sounds interesting so as not to cause it to hurt the annual operating budgets.
And didn't they discuss asking for more this year, and then you talked
they
about
did
it?
Because I said 4.5 is a stretch to begin with. I didn't want
yeah.
them to go over the 4.5, but I wish we had thought about it prior to the
well, it, you really didn't have, you know, if there's an override, you can have that flexibility without it, it'd be hard.
Yeah, where the budget's been so constrained and we're using so much free cash, you didn't
yeah.
see that we had any real room
I agree.
To go the other way, so.
If there's a quote that you should hang over your bed at night, it should be this one from the beginning. Reading's GO bonds are eligible to be rated above the sovereign because we believe the town can maintain better credit characteristics than the nation in a stress scenario.
That is really sad.
Well, that's not my mantra.
Wow. That was a major compliment.
I like that. I thought that was great. I highlighted it, literally.
I'll put something else
about
my bed.
I was like, that's smart.
Okay. Review of public listening sessions. So, I'm not sure who was able to attend sessions. I got to two of them, and I know you're at least one, because I saw you at one. I know if others were. Great. I'm gonna give you kind of my thoughts and then open it for yours as well. What was very interesting to me, I don't know if it's interesting, kind of confirmed something. Most people in town aren't particularly aware of all the things that are going on around town. And they don't know how the budget works. And when the session kind of said, well, you know, are there services that you could see giving up or cuts or whatever, people were not sure how to respond. They just didn't have context to work from. It was just very difficult. So, you know, kind of asking for it, they were kind of, you know, show me some stuff. So what that reinforced to me is that very, people need to understand in very simple terms kind of what the budget is, how the town works, the situation that we find ourselves in, and then what options that's going to bring forward. And then people at that point are able to make a decision. I also heard some people who were saying, and you know, I think Mr. Ryan came back too, is, you know, without knowing, you know, I can't, I'm against it until I know what it is. Which, you know, in some ways isn't totally unreasonable, but it just this I had this very strong feeling listening to the questions that people just, they don't pay attention and don't have time to pay attention the way we do. That's kind of, you know, what our job is, what town meeting's job is, what the nighttime government groups are all very, very involved in. But somehow that message has to get translated to other people so that they at least have an understanding of to vote or not to vote on whatever the issue is. That's kind of what I took from it. I thought that there were people who seemed at first concerned and then started to change their minds. I think there were people on we're seeing both sides. Some people very strongly, you know, this has to happen. Other people saying it can't happen. I think there was both of the sessions I went to, particularly the first one, there were some probably senior citizens who expressed concern about, you know, how do we pay? How does this work? And there were some creative suggestions about the senior center that came as well. But that's kind of what I was, you know, hearing from people. And my strongest takeaway from it was it's going to be very difficult for people to be able to kind of understand, you know, what the vote will be about, other than, you know, it's a tax increase, but what does that mean? You know, where is money being spent? Is it being spent wisely? What happens if we do? What happens if we don't? And how to convey that very simply. It's going to be quite a challenge. That's kind of my takeaway. And you have comments?
It felt similar to probably Financial Forum or a presentation at town meeting, insofar as I feel like a lot of people are getting information for the first time. And rather than offering, you know, so I felt like it was a community listening session, but the community was listening.
Yeah, that's not what we intended.
But that's really what it felt like. The community
yeah.
was listening to the town about the state of the town's finances, more so than the town having an opportunity to hear what, and insofar as there were thoughts embedded within the questions that were presented, but it felt like most people were starting from square one in terms of learning about the current financial status of the town. So there's certainly an education piece, but also, to your point, I think it's going to be hard for people to vote based, you know, for an override based on the financial condition of the town if most people don't understand what that is. I feel like people are going to want to vote for something. Rather than, you know,
absolutely.
Maintaining the status quo and services when most people aren't going, unless they've been coming to financial forums, have attended a community listening session. But I think they're going to need something tangible to vote for, something new perhaps, or that they're going to have to point to something. To feel comfortable, I think, voting for an override rather than, you know, we don't want to lose anything that we have currently. So,
Mark, do you have any other thoughts?
Yeah, I think people wanted a bottom line. I heard that time and time again, but what does this really mean to me? you know, like how much is this going to cost me? And I feel like that's one of the things that if people can get their head around, ah, this isn't gonna break me financially, then maybe, you know, positive or negative, you know,
yeah,
kind of that positive or negative carrot, so to speak, you know, in either direction you could swallow it. I think that was number one. I feel like that question came, well, how much is it? You know, how much is it gonna cost me? I've heard that a bunch, and I mean, I haven't went to one meeting, but I heard that multiple times in that meeting. I think the other thing that was apparent to me was that it, like, just like you were saying, it was an information session for most people, and they went to it with that mindset. So they didn't go to with an opinion that they wanted to express to the town. It was them sitting and listening to what the town said. It was really just an information session, which I think is good. But to the, I think this bond rating that was obviously just issued, I guess is a good word, is a really good outside stamp of approval that the town is run well. Whether you like what's been done or not, a very reputable outside source has now sort of put their seal of approval on the town, saying the town does a great job. Not just a good job, a great job. So, you know, I think sort of, and that's independent, right? No, that's not anyone's opinion. That's, you know, S&P's opinion. So I'm hoping that helps in some way, that, you know, in hindsight, that people can say, town's run well, whether you agree or disagree, an outside person says it. So hopefully that makes this, you know, easier, whichever way it goes, that people can say, hey, no mistakes have been made. Whatever we need to do in the future, we can do well for the town.
Yeah. Vanessa, you were at least one also, right?
I attended two of the sessions, and I had sort of side conversations with people as I attended, people that were sort of mumbling in the background. And one of the things that I heard and at both meetings came up was the commercial tax base and why that couldn't absorb more of our current situation. And I think the concept was difficult for people to grasp,
mm-hmm.
in that even if it changed, it doesn't mean, even if we shifted the burden, it does not mean
more revenue.
It
yeah.
still remains the same. I
yeah.
from what I was hearing, that message was not absorbed.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think that's a big hang up, because people are saying, well, why do I have to absorb this? Why can't the commercial tax base in town absorb that? So that was one. And then the other thing that I heard quite a bit about, actually, was if we knew that an override was coming, why is it that we have chosen perhaps optional expenses? The library, the lighting in Birch Meadows. So if we knew these things were coming, and we have the shortfall, why are we choosing to spend why did we choose to spend funds in these areas that are not quote unquote necessary? So I think there's a lack of I think a lot of people are not, as you said, aware of much of the things that are happening in the town, and I think the library project is a big one, because yes, it was voted on and approved, but I think a lot of people didn't necessarily know what it meant. And I can see that causing a little bit of friction. So not only did you do these things and there's a tax consequence for everybody, but now you're asking me for money. Why do you keep asking me for more money? And these are some of the sort of grumblings that I heard floating around in the background.
One more thing I'd add, that's a great point, was there needs to be a discussion of how the average tax bill breaks down, and to the point of 96% of our debt being under 10 years, when things are gonna come off.
Mm-hmm.
So things that were voted on, the library, the schools, the other
mm-hmm.
activities, when they're gonna come off, people wanna understand that also. You know, here's the bill now, here are the pieces. Year 8, that comes off. Year 9, that comes off, whatever, so that they understand that more completely.
Mm-hmm.
I heard that from a lot of folks. Nancy.
Just one thing, I only went to one meeting that I'm reminded of. What was the most popular Google search after the London vote?
Brexit. What is Brexit?
Brexit is what
is
the
EU?
Yeah.
And I think that's what you're really all commenting on, is there is in fact a real lack of what people
yeah.
understand. And I'll be honest with you, I don't think the town is prepared for this vote in the fall, and I'm concerned about the amount of time and energy is being put forth when people really don't understand. And that's my worry, is that it's a setup not to pass.
problem is people never start listening until you start going
to vote.
Well,
no, until you start doing it, and
they
you might
don't.
Have to do that.
Yeah.
You might have to do
yep.
that, but my concern is departments that are dependent on an override now,
mm-hmm.
that I think it's the next time.
And it will, but if you never go, people never listen. And it sounds harsh, but people don't engage till they need to.
Yeah, I totally understand your point, Nancy, but from the last successful
mm-hmm.
override, from the start of the public discussion till the vote, was 10 weeks. We're doing it now. You could argue a year, maybe 6 months. It is much longer. If you do it too soon, you just lose everyone's attention. So
mm-hmm.
it's kind of a balancing act. But certainly, the other takeaway from the listening sessions that no one mentioned was protect the elders, protect the seniors in their homes.
Yeah,
that was especially true during the daytime at the senior center, but it was true in the two night sessions as well.
Mm-hmm.
And that is something the selectmen have addressed, and quite mm-hmm. to the happiness of the people at the senior center, one in particular, she was thrilled.
And that was, and you put that forward in your presentation. And
yeah, but it's really hard to know who's going to walk into the room and what level you need to talk at.
And I think some people had come into the room after you'd given the presentation, and because some of the questions they asked suggested they hadn't heard that piece.
I
think that's probably representative of,
yeah.
you know, people are coming into the conversation
right.
at all different
right.
different stages.
I saw more people that I didn't recognize and talked
mm-hmm.
with, actually a lot of them. And they'd never been to a town meeting, they'd never been to a
right.
public meeting. I said, how did you hear about it? Word of mouth. So somehow the word of mouth on this
mm.
one worked. I really don't know why.
Mm-hmm.
But we were seeing a lot of new faces in there. And so that's why there wasn't a lot of education going on, because there wasn't town meeting members coming to these.
Exactly.
There was an active push at the schools. There were people handing out flyers.
Okay.
At the end of the day, and there were emails being sent out to group lists. So I know from the school side of it that a lot of parents were very active in trying to spread the word.
I was just noticing that there was that lack of understanding about splitting the tax rate wasn't going to create any more revenue, but I think they did get around, I mean, at least to the one I saw where you explained it very well, that they digested the fact that if we did do some split, that it could provide a little bit of relief so that an override doesn't hurt as much. I think people get that.
Yeah.
And I feel like some people kind of seem to be suggesting that that would help them make the decision to vote for an override, to see an effort on our part to charge a little bit more to the commercial tax base.
I do think it would be very helpful for the selectmen to come up with a single-page summary on the whole split tax rate thing.
They're meeting
we
with
have
the,
gotten
uh,
off course on multiple
yeah.
meetings now over this. And
yeah.
if you at least state the facts, at this point, I don't even care which way they vote, but it's really a distraction.
Yeah.
And
it wasn't the first meeting.
It's a single-page summary, and also a single-page to say, okay, if you get relief of $50, just understand it costs that commercial guy $1,000, or whatever that
yeah,
multiplier
whatever
is.
Yeah, the selectmen are going to meet jointly with the Board of Assessors at their second July meeting, and that's when stuff will be much more public. They can't really do it by themselves. They have to have the blessing of the Board of Assessors, if you will. So that's why it's been a little bit slow to develop. But, you know, they are coming up with some really creative tax policy that I keep suggesting should be state law, but
mm-hmm.
it hasn't got that far yet. You know, I think that'll be a lot clearer in July.
Because the financial form.
Could you think about, I mean, it's not reasonable to do all of these listening sessions, but you do have the September fair. Is it possible to have something there where it's an ability you're going to have a lot of
that's
people?
That's too late, I would say.
That's too
well,
late.
Well,
maybe. When is the next?
Well, September 1st is meant to be, first of all, there may be other meetings, but September 1st
okay.
there's a community meeting at the high school. And it's meant
okay.
to present the solutions from what the town heard. And that's meant to be town
yes.
meeting members,
okay.
who knows
so
who else
timing.
Comes in.
Okay. That, I didn't
so September 1st is meant to be in advance of the special town meeting.
So here's the, okay.
And then Fall Street Fair is a day before the special town meeting. But that could help the voters.
Okay. Right.
That could, yeah.
Yeah, I think that's
you
a great idea.
You could at least have something there, you know,
yeah.
as Paul is saying, because
yeah.
you're going to have a lot of people who don't get the newspaper, or don't
sure.
do any of this, and take advantage of that, and advertise.
Yeah, and we obviously have to be a little careful. We're not advocates.
No, but
other
see,
people can
see,
be,
no,
but you're right, putting
information
out
about the warrant article.
Just state the facts.
Yeah.
Information about the warrant article to be taken up the next night.
Yeah.
For
just a reminder that there is a vote.
Yeah.
I
well, there won't be
honestly,
until
the
but there
meeting,
won't be
but,
until, yeah, the next
well, but that there is an ongoing issue. That I mean, put something, right? You're going to
yeah.
get the largest crowd gathering in Reading you will
yeah.
get for the
I
year.
I know, it's great PR. It's a
just,
great idea.
Right.
Even
just
come talk
hey.
To whoever, you know, have different people on.
Just do something.
If some of you that have been around on FinCom for long enough remember five-ish years ago, for maybe 3 years in a row, I put out four different budget articles during the spring, just before town meeting. It took a lot of time and a lot of effort working with the newspaper. I got zero questions, and after 3 years, I said, that's it. Nobody cares. And that's fine. I'm not offended in the least bit. But I just said, putting something in the newspaper is not the way to communicate information to people. And honestly, I don't really know what is. I think in person is, but you can't talk to 25,000 people at the same time.
How many people are on the distribution list for the town? For example, I get emails when there's road construction or when there's the mosquito spraying and that kind of thing. So how many people are on those lists in town?
I don't think there is an answer to that. We have maybe 4,000 on the biggest email list I can think of, 4,000 households out of 9,000. That schools probably have more than that. I don't know if this stuff's appropriate, though, to be going through those channels. It, again, factual information, but...
Right.
It's definitely a gray area.
But could you be able to put out the message that an override vote is out there through that sort
do
of
want
media,
to?
Or would that overspread?
You know, there's a lot of questions.
Or that
there.
There'll be a town booth at the Reading
yeah.
Street there.
Yeah.
Maybe better. The
information.
You know, advocate groups should and will do whatever they want to do for or against.
Right.
And they'll stir up kind of the emotional side. We just got to be ready with the factual side as best we can.
Right.
Pictures.
And he's from the post office.
Hmm?
He's from the post office.
Oh, okay, yeah, right. Yeah. Oh, they're moving that next week, by the way.
Oh.
Nobody knows that, but
oh my
well,
god,
they've announced it.
They put a sign on the letter.
There's a sign there, but it's not that noticeable.
Yeah,
I didn't realize I was walking by. Like, oh,
wow.
Moving across the street to Eastern Bank.
Who's buying that?
So since we're kind of on this topic, should we go a little bit out of order to the last topic, which is FinCom role in providing financial information to the community this summer? I think we're starting to, we're talking about what the town may need to do here. And then the question is, what role can we play to be helpful along those lines? Clearly, giving feedback already is one. Two, I think, is as the sessions, the BOS meetings are taking place this summer, we probably should think about having some coverage from FinCom at those meetings. I think, Peter, you and I, the liaisons to Selectmen.
Oh, that's not
yeah.
right.
Oh, that's sorry.
22.
You're right. Sorry. You know what? Maybe we've got to do the reorganization assignments for whoever's on that list. We probably ought to figure out how we can get to some of those meetings.
I should also add that the school committee at least twice has discussed the FY18 budget in public. And I missed Mondays. It was off cable, so I didn't get to see it. But, you know, John is further ahead than I am, certainly, in the public or even a thinking discussion about FY18. So I think to some of your points, we've always known that we have to be more explicit, even though we want to protect morale, and say this many layoffs. And, you know, how you do it, we'll have to be careful, but you may have to specify departments, let's say, and John may specify teachers. So, you know, they are having now public discussions about numbers and impacts at a broad, high level. And we know it has to go there. So when someone wants to know the number and wants the impact, I totally understand that. They're going to want to know, what am I going to lose if it doesn't pass, and what am I going to gain if it does? And the other sentiment from the three meetings that I went to that seemed to come through to me are, well, given that we're not going to cut anything, why do I need to vote in an override for you? Because I don't necessarily want more things. It's like, no, you don't understand. Without an override, you're not going to have what you want. That's the single biggest message that needs to get out there, and the schools are totally on board. You know, there's things people want. the override is not about what we want unless it's what we already have. You know, maybe there's other things. You know, the most obvious one to me on our side is a middle school, a second school resource officer. That's a want. That's a nice thing. But if we don't get an override, not only are we not going to have that, we're not going to have a lot of other things. And that's the message that needs to get put out. When Melrose's override failed, they did not have any cuts if an override failed. They only had additions. And I think they learned a lesson.
Oh, wow.
It was mostly school things. It was, I don't remember the number, but 100,000 for police and 1 million and change for schools. All new things, and it lost. There was not a single cut mentioned. They didn't need to make any cuts. We clearly do have to make cuts, even if we're not sure how much. And may not be till even after a vote.
But will there be additional services or personnel, you know, with an override? So yes, we
don't really know yet. That's the ongoing discussion. I mean, I think the answer has to be yes, from a marketing standpoint.
I was gonna say it's a sexier
sell. Maybe more on the schools. So.
And from the school and from the library, they've been asking for these few specific roles for years, and if we have the override and they don't get them, I can see there being a certain amount of disgruntled.
Yeah.
But in terms of process, and you're asking how what the role we play, I would hope we're an integral part of that decision about what that amount should be.
I don't know yet.
I don't know.
We haven't had any discussion.
Yeah, I don't know what else
I've
the
done
role
stuff
of FinCom would be if it wasn't that. Well,
yeah.
Who decides it?
Selectmen. They also decide the language, but I'm sure it's a joint discussion. Quite sure. You know, chairs of library trustees, selectmen, and school committee have met a couple times, and staff, but haven't got to this level yet. We're talking a lot of other things that are conceptual, but not to actual specifics. And that's because on the town side, we just haven't done any. We're trying to close the year. After next week, we'll be able to do that. You know, but we do have to get down to specifics. And effectively, I've realized we're going to have to build an FY18 budget in the next month and have different lines of funding and show what order it would be, at least internally, so we can have a discussion. You know, department heads haven't really had an in-depth discussion yet on this. I've had it individually with department heads, and just to be real clear, every single department will be cut somehow, so no one is being protected.
Should we try to do multi-year in just one
year? Oh, absolutely. Yeah, I've mentally kind of served the FY25 and FY30 as two objectives. 30 is probably going to cost too much to balance to, but 25 is reasonable. And that's where our debt exclusions happen to run to. So 10 years sounds better, but 8 years or whatever that is more practical.
Sure, 5 years.
You know, I started at 2030 for whatever reason, and it's so expensive to get the last few years now.
Yeah.
You have to effectively save half of your override in the first year in order to stretch it out. So if we're going to do you pick a number, $1 million override, and you can only spend $500,000 in the first year, no one's going to be happy about that. But that's the construct, and we either get there directly or indirectly by reducing the amount of free cash you use to balance the budget.
Which is so a little bit off topic, but still same here. Are we rated by Moody's, or is it just S&P?
We have no rating, but I think we would be an underlying AA.
Okay.
A AA2 probably, I'm not sure.
And on S&P, as you discussed with them, so typically Moody's have better methodology in order to try to find out, you know, what the implications are if you go below certain levels.
Not for Muni's.
Not for Muni's.
Corporates,
for corporates, okay.
So
there is no way we can show, because one of the angle I'm trying to get at is, hey, based on litigation, and as you go down, some of these leverages goes up and cash balances goes down, we'll be subject to downgrade, and downgrades equal higher interest expense. And so
you know,
forth.
The real answer to that is, you know, when I lived in that world, every basis point counted.
Yeah.
But when you're in this world, it makes no difference.
Right.
Honestly.
Why?
Whether or not we save $25,000 or $50,000 in interest. Out of a $100 million budget, who cares?
Yeah.
Right, and people. I think from these listening sessions, people their issues are sort of more basic, Yeah, like they're not, they can digest that.
And our problems are bigger.
Yeah, they, I don't think they would digest that the way I think you would or most people in this room would, you know, because we.
And they surely don't get passionate enough about that to go, get out and vote.
Right,
right, right, right, two basis points, get out and vote.
Right, right.
On debt that we don't even have yet.
Yeah, yeah.
No, I think it's a good thought, don't get me wrong, I'm not shooting it down, just shooting it down.
I'm just saying, I'm having my treasure at hand.
Who's moving, right, like, I don't even know, like.
It's hard to abandon that way of thinking, but I have.
But I think, coming back to Paula's point too, I think that we certainly need to play both an informal and a formal role, I think, in what's happening. And just as an example, and personal opinion, and following Vanessa's point also, I think that if this is positioned as a save, cut versus save, I think it's gonna lose. I think that's just has no chance. And so I hear you about you can't spend it all up front and don't disagree. But I think that there need to be reasons to believe and kind of we're gonna save half and we're gonna be even. It doesn't create a reason to believe. It kind of is a, I don't know, it's almost a show me. You know, that's all I'm gonna get? Show me. Let me see the blood on the streets.
Go back and eat.
I sorry, personal opinion. I think you need something that people can get behind.
And that's why I think you need to balance shorter.
Yeah.
You know, you don't go for a longer override because it's just so silly.
It's like a Christmas movie.
Yeah. 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 That was the only way I could emphasize that point.
The dog show.
So on the informal basis, I think we probably should be having people attending the selectmen meetings. On a formal basis, I think we should probably schedule some meetings for ourselves this summer. And I think that when we do kind of the reorganization of chairs, it's probably worthwhile to spend some time with the other chairs talking about it and what's going on. I think that's the next step that has to happen here too.
Can we do sort of more pointed financial forms?
Pointed?
Like toward the issues that.
Override form.
Yeah, an override form.
Have a look at page 23, and that's sort of calendar.
Okay. Did I jump ahead?
So I misspoke earlier. I said September 1st. It's really September 7th is the first financial form, and it's meant to discuss the override, basically, you know, a week before town meeting.
That's great.
And I don't know who's going to come, but we're certainly going to invite all town meeting members. You know, I hope at least some of them show up.
Yep. That's a bit more of a presentation. I think July,
that
August
is
when
and
stuff
then,
is coming again.
Well, that's what I meant. I was thinking backing up earlier, I agree. But if we did sort of more sessions, you know, that we could, people could come and do, we could answer questions that have come up as this develops. I feel like people are going to have more questions and more issues as this develops, and having an outlet to air those could be helpful in the overall process, wherever you fall out.
Yep, absolutely. I think the other thing is, and I wasn't at the second listening session, but I was told by a number of people that there were comments to the effect of, well, what does the finance committee think about that?
Mm.
And what's their opinion?
Yeah.
At which point I was very glad that I wasn't at that session. but... you know, there. It would be very helpful to the process, to the voters, I think, if kind of we're kind of with the group that's putting it together more so than if we are kind of reviewing it. And I think that there are enough people here involved enough in the town that we probably feel we want to be able to do that. And so I think we should all be reaching out to the selectmen. I think we also should encourage people to reach out to their selectmen and share their opinions in terms of what's going on and you know, what their interests are. I was on a, last anecdotal story, I was on a bike ride and I was just talking with people. They said, you know, how you doing, whatever. Folks who I don't spend much time with, and, you know, we're talking about, I don't know, town officials or something. So I'm a town official too. And they're like, yeah, oh, cool, you know, what's going on? And like, have you heard about the discussions on the budget and stuff? And they're like, no, what's going on? And it was, it's not on people, it's not the tip of their tongues.
Yeah.
But I think once the override is decided on in Yeah, you have a dollar
amount. I think
that's right. That's
what
the issue is, Mark. I think that people don't have anything to talk about yet.
Right.
It's not. It, the issue is kind of.
Yeah.
Yeah. Is vapor. It needs to.
It's very
you know,
pointed
mm-hmm.
to us, but not to other people yet.
Yeah.
If you give a dollar value of how it affects them, then people start to think that's
important. Oh yeah. Oh yeah.
And what will happen if they don't?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So why don't we look at this calendar and maybe. If it makes sense to folks, should we schedule a summer meeting or two? Sorry, go ahead.
I haven't talked about this with Selectman and John as with the school committee, but we've talked with each other. We know it's important to have July, August meetings, but we're wondering if we don't just set them up and whoever can come from those bodies come, as opposed to you're never going to get all of FinCom, all the Selectmen, all the school
right.
committee. So, but, you know, we were talking about what the topics would be. And one of the requests that came out of the listening sessions, which I do not think is worth a meeting, is show me what you've already done in the last 3 to 5 years that you tell me you've done, because I don't believe you or I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
That's maybe an important element, but it's not worth a meeting. That's like the most boring meeting I can ever imagine. So maybe that's some portion of a bigger thing, but we don't really know, other than having, again, a general listening session, what topic, unless tax stuff has been decided, and that won't be till the end July at the soonest. We don't know if there's really a topic we can go out and advertise and get people to. I think it's almost worth just saying every Wednesday night for the next 6 weeks, there will be members of the school committee, selectmen, FinCom, and staff available for any of your questions, or something like that. And then who knows what questions walk in the door, if any. I did learn last night that a lot of people like zoning when there's wine in Reading Co-op Bank has a session with wine.
I was thinking if you do the Reading Street Fair, you need to have something to attract the kids.
Yeah.
Because the kids' parents will follow the kids to the booth.
Enjoy
the best.
Fall Street Fair, there might not be one next year.
Yeah. We could volunteer for Pin the Tail on the Bus.
Bounce your financial troubles away.
That's right.
So I think
I don't like having that big gap.
Yeah.
But you have to have something worth doing, and I'm just not really sure what it is, other than just be available. I'm happy to take ideas, certainly.
What you're talking about, just financial meetings, or two?
Yeah, I think we should have ourselves scheduled again. You know, on September 7th, if there's a forum,
yeah,
you got to
meet before that.
Yeah,
so.
we'll be expected to have participated, reviewed, and have some thoughts. So,
yeah,
we need to get involved with that. So, would it make sense to try and hold a date in July and two in August, something like that, or one in each?
Right, and we were talking about we're going to revisit our whole policy.
I think you should do
reserve,
one in each
so.
And then see what happens.
Yeah.
July 13th or
20th? No, I have the 13th already. Why is that?
That's the second Wednesday.
Oh, I just have a recurring meeting.
But it works for me, so.
I don't know that we'll have that much, right? 13th?
The 13th is soon.
That's only 2 weeks away.
Yeah.
Wow.
Could I suggest maybe
20th?
The 20th?
Fine. You know, the assessors won't have met yet, but I'm sure there's something we can have to do.
So I'm sorry, the date, what?
July 20th.
How about the 17th, a couple weeks before that, 2-3 weeks before that financial forum? That might be too soon, I don't know.
I personally am not here that week, but.
24th then?
24th would be better for me personally.
July 24th.
I guess.
August 24th.
Is your objective to be prepared for the financial forum? That's the main objective?
I think that for the August meeting, that's probably what that is. I think the July meeting is more, hopefully, as things are still being formed, and maybe as you have ideas that people are starting to chomp on, that we get to kind of chime in and with our thoughts on them as well. And again, maybe some of that's informal, and maybe that's
informal. This doesn't sound good, but then the 31st of August is best. Labor Day is the 5th. It's the Wednesday before Labor Day.
August 3rd.
But you know, a week before then, I'm sure it's still going to be in flux, in some way.
Yeah,
it's not going to be presentable to you at least.
So the thirty-first work, August thirty-first?
Yeah, I can't make the thirty-first.
We'll call you.
Yeah.
I have a question, at the thirty-first, are we expecting, is it really, I understand the meetings are opening, but open to the public, but are we expecting an audience at that meeting? And the only reason I mention that is because I think that's the week school starts.
Probably.
So it's more just what the event, who do we expect to attend?
Take a larger room.
Do they start before Labor Day next year?
Yes.
They do.
Okay, yeah, that, then they're probably starting on this year Thursday.
So maybe pick a larger room.
Yeah.
Either senior center or Coolidge multipurpose or something like that.
Or is that a bad week?
I just, I'm thinking it might just be a bad week from anyone who has.
When does school usually start? I thought it was like a Thursday, Friday.
I think it's.
Wednesday, Wednesday, Thursday, and then they're off Friday.
And they skip Friday, okay.
Yeah.
So that, that's.
Thirty-first, I think, if we wanna engage people, they're not gonna be engaged.
I mean, it'll be the first day of school, yeah.
So you wanna do, were you saying pre or post school start?
Why were we thinking not the twenty-fourth, or was that bad?
I don't think we're gonna be ready to present you something nearly as well as, I mean, you're, if you ever knew what shape we're in 3 weeks before town meeting, you'd be amazed that we could stand up at town meeting.
Well, all right, is that the purpose of our, that, August?
I think that's.
For August, I thought, yes, for July, I think it's more formative.
We have our agenda, sorry.
What about Monday, the twenty-ninth?
Sorry.
I have a meeting, but it's in this room.
Or Thursday, the first.
I had a financial forum scheduled for that thing.
Really?
Well, that was Thursday, the first.
Perfect. No, I think from the last, did we have that from last year's?
So the twenty-ninth and the first?
I might have told you that, and it's really the seventh.
It's the seventh, yeah, because I wrote down the first one.
If you're gonna do it on the first, why not the thirty-first? It's the same concept of school.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Except that there's no school on Friday.
First.
But would people be gone away for that long?
I don't think you're gonna expect public at this meeting, I mean.
Yeah.
I'd be glad if they come to the one on the seventh. Historically.
Well, that's why I asked more.
The listening sessions are good because there are different people, but it's not like there are hundreds of people. And anytime we've tried to get people together before important town meeting vote, it almost never succeeds, like zoning. They must have had 40 or 50 public meetings. And their attendance was better than most towns get, but very few town meeting members went, which surprised me. Business community was interested and other folks were interested.
I'm confused about my September 7th finance forum. Are we gonna be presenting the budget if an override doesn't pass, or just present?
We haven't decided yet. Other than we know that we have to give information in advance of a town meeting. So honestly, I don't know what level of detail, we just haven't talked about.
So thirty-first?
We have.
Why don't we hold the thirty-first?
Thirty-first.
So July 20th and August 31st. Let's put those on for now.
And I will look for another room for the August meeting.
It won't be necessary.
I don't think so.
Couple more seats. I think the other part actually is, as long as we can be on TV and have it recorded, that may have some value.
Somebody can see it.
Yep, people who can't make it can watch it.
Yeah, my guess is, if I were a town meeting member, would I come to this in advance of the one the next week? Probably not.
Right.
Right.
You know, I've already got the warrant booked by then. No, sorry, it's a financial forum, not a town meeting.
Yeah.
Well, that's an interesting question. If there's a town meeting on the 12th, people probably will have the warrant book in their hands by the 31st.
It'd be a great opportunity for a pre-meeting.
So, the 31st, you should have really good information. I change what I said. You know, I have to get stuff ready by August for the town meeting. That, you know, August 16th is when the selectmen decide about a town meeting. So that's a little tight. So I guess I have to assume they're going to and start getting working. Right, so I'm not gonna have any time off this summer.
It does seem like
we're not gonna
be very fast.
I know, I lose all my vacations.
That's right, use it or lose it. Well, like lose it or lose
exactly.
It.
Yeah,
well,
I'll see that again.
We'll pay you off this year.
All right, is the rest of the schedule on page 23?
Yeah, I think it's important that you do meet on October 26th after the election, no matter what, in that financial forum, because then you'll have some concrete things to discuss in terms of budget guidance. regular meetings, you may as well always schedule them, but you can cancel if you don't need to come. And the January financial forum is pretty much always optional, you just never know. Let me ask you, and this will be also a question for the selectmen, do you see any advantage in inviting our three legislators to any of these?
Yes.
What about this 12%?
I was thinking the special. I was thinking the special town meeting in September would be a good one. That's when the public is there speaking, really.
I actually think a financial forum might be a great place for them to come also.
Think so.
Yeah, first of all, you got all the boards together. And this is front and center to their base, right?
Yeah, I gotta remember there's a state election in there somewhere. I didn't put it on your list. It's in September.
Oh really?
I think it's a Thursday. It might be the 8th. The 7th might not be the best day to invite them.
No, it's just a state primary.
State primary.
Did they have Tuesdays?
No, they're doing a Thursday because of Labor Day.
Labor Day.
So we can't invite them on the 7th. That would be mean.
Okay, let's see what's possible. All right. Reorganization liaison assignments. So each year we convene and we talk about having a chair and a vice chair and then set up liaison assignments. You can see the last year's assignments. I'm sorry,
good. New member.
Oh, yes. So we will have, effective July 1st, next fiscal year, Eric Burkhart is going to join. Craig decided not to kind of re-up. Sorry, he's not here tonight. We could wish him well. Anyway, he's very happy, very involved in the Coolidge science team right now. Extremely involved. But Eric Burkhart's going to join. You may remember Eric at the last town meeting when we had the issue of the gun discussions. And he was the person who was kind of representing the residents. And he was the one, I thought, who kind of kept everybody grounded and calm and focused on the issues of how do we preserve safety here.
They
did a great job.
Sounds like a great addition.
Yeah, we had a great discussion with him last night as well. So he'll be joining us. And that's a net positive for us.
So effective when?
July 1st. Once he's sworn in, but as soon as possible after July 1st. So yeah, we'll get all the schedules and things and he should be available for all those. So we'll be back to 9, which is a great place to be, fellow FinCom members. We need to talk about who we want to have chair, vice chair for this coming year.
When does yours go through now? Are you
19?
I'm to 19. Oh yeah, so sorry. So Paul and I were both reappointed, so we're to 19. And then I will time out. That's my third term. That'll be the end of Mark and FinCom.
Oh, so you're saying these turn to 19?
Yeah.
Yes.
Right?
The 3 16s go to 19.
Except Craig, actually. Yeah, Craig.
Paul, I'm not really sure what your situation is when the bylaw changed.
I'm not either.
No, Paul.
Oh.
Yeah.
I don't know. Oh,
Paul.
Is that my start date?
Yeah, I guess you're kind of in the same boat, actually.
Yeah.
I have to figure out exactly what date you got appointed.
Okay.
I believe, and don't hold this, I believe the new bylaw says you can do effectively up to 10 years.
Right.
So the first
that's
year
right.
or less
sounds
doesn't
right.
count
three
against
full
you,
terms,
but if it's 13 months, you can't. So I think you can't, but I just don't know.
That's
I think you were a year and a half. I just don't remember when you came in mid-year. Who did you replace, do you know?
No.
This FinCom trivia question.
Yeah.
Marcy West?
I don't know.
Okay.
She wasn't here when I got here.
Didn't track.
So we need to elect chair and vice chair for this year. I think it will be a busy year for whoever takes those roles.
Looking for nominations?
Discussion or nominations, yes.
Well, I'll start. I'd like to nominate Mark as the chair. I think he's done a phenomenal job throughout his time as the chair this past year. I know we're in for a busy year. Personally, would feel very comfortable with Mark in place.
I would second that if you're willing to do that.
I would third that.
Other nominations?
You're not
I will say in the history of FinCom, I've never known anyone to do 3 years in a row, so I don't know if that's a good or a bad thing, quite honestly.
Do you accept the nomination?
So I think it is an important year and I would accept the nomination, yes.
I think you have the continuity of the work that you've been doing too will be important.
Absolutely. If I do it, I will need a lot of help. I do
mm-hmm.
think that we'll have a challenging year.
Yes.
So, but thank you. I will do that. So any other nominations? Close the nominations. All right. All those in favor of me?
Officer Joy, you vote.
Great. Happy to do that. Vice Chair.
I'll nominate Paul again if you're willing to accept the nomination.
I second that. I would be.
He doesn't have to be willing.
Yeah. Others who may have interest or other nominations?
I'll
close the
nominations.
All right, nominations are closed. All right, all those in favor of Paul? We are 9-0-0. Thank you, guys. I think that a couple things. One, I absolutely will not be chairman for life. That can't happen. So I think this makes sense on continuity for this year.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm happy to step up to that, but I would very much like after that to move on. So, and there are a lot of other folks here who I know I think can do a great job at it too. So let's make sure we get that going. We do need to figure out how we can cover a lot of these meetings that are going to come up. Do you have Bob, the selectman schedule? Are they on? They're not on every Tuesday in the summer, are they?
No. July. Is that a 12th and 26th. August, I'm not sure. But 12th and 26th. 12th, there will definitely be discussion about this topic because there's no agenda items, well, there's one. And then 26th has got the assessors coming in, so that's an important meeting also related to financial. And then August may not, I'm not sure. They also know they may need to schedule extra meetings.
Has Paula sent out a packet to them before each of their meetings?
Yeah.
It's just an email anyway.
Yeah.
Is there any reason we can't all be at it just to
ask their permission?
We have to ask their permission.
It goes to the selectmen on Thursday, and then it gets posted to the website and the public on Monday. And that's always happened for time ad nauseum. So it's just a courtesy thing. I'll ask the selectmen if they mind if anyone else sees it. Department heads get it also, but that's all. So,
I know I just react more to things incoming than thinking, go check the website.
Yeah, I'll ask. There are some people who ask for it and get it on Monday. Was it Monday morning?
Yeah.
I don't care if that's our.
So at the very least, you can get it.
That'll be a good prompt.
You know, historically, information flowed a lot slower,
right.
So it made sense that they have a chance to see it, but now it really matters.
So let's do liaison assignments, and then let's also talk about the 12th and 26th specifically and see if we might have enough members to host for those meetings, or maybe we post just as a precaution. Why don't we just post as a precaution? The 12th and 26th we'll post as a group. So assignments. I think it's probably important that I stay with the selectmen. It's probably less important I stay on the audit committee. but I'd like to stay with the selectmen. I think that makes sense. We probably should have, I think this year we had 3 on the selectmen. I think we should do at least 3, if not 4. Who would like to join the selectmen band here?
Oh, I would actually be willing to continue. I just need some reminders because I don't go out to the website to look and see when the meetings are. So
I would do it.
A reminder would certainly.
I would do it as well. You need a 4th.
So we're at 3 currently. We have one more. And your selectmen as well. You want to say?
I am. I may be somewhat out of commission in August.
Yeah.
Why? What's your situation?
No, where are your priorities?
All the more reason to go to 4.
Yes.
So,
Mark said he would.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay.
Mark. Yeah.
So I'll stay
for July for as long as you can.
Mark time.
Okay.
In 6 months, you'll be begging to go out of meeting.
Yeah, you're going to be.
Sorry, you got to watch me.
I thought, was that the forward pass? What anyway, okay, great. Schools.
I'd like to stay on
schools.
I can stay on schools. I've done that for a while.
I've been on schools. I do. I like schools. So happy to stay.
There are going to be at a lot of meetings.
There's
three. Both.
Yeah.
It's fine.
I could do one or the other, I guess.
What we could do is we have two, three on schools now. We could do the same thing, go to four. Maybe that's not a bad thought.
I can join schools. I have the library, which also meets pretty regularly.
Yes.
And I'd like to stay on that one, unless someone else would like to do it. I may not attend as many. I may not be able to attend all the school ones.
I did feel like it was, in, particularly in January this
yeah.
year, it was a lot of meetings.
Lot.
Like it was a lot of
two
three
a
nights a week if we had a financial
right.
forum
yeah.
or a finance committee meeting kind of thing.
Yeah.
So
if we had Paul, Vanessa, Anne, and Paula, that'd give us enough coverage.
And we can
rotate as needed.
Rotate
right.
as needed.
Right. So the only issue is going to be when we know there are meetings or when the liaisons know there are important meetings, maybe let the group know because
mm-hmm.
we may want to post. I found myself going to most of the school meetings in January last year,
mm-hmm.
and we don't want to have five if we're not posted.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, let's keep going. Who wants the audit committee? Who would like to join
I'll stay
in?
On. I mean, I'll stay on. I stay on that for consistency.
And David has volunteered.
All right.
Thank you, sir.
Don't forget you have Eric to pick on.
Right.
Okay, whatever.
The library building committee is going away, correct? Theoretically.
Not for a little while, at least.
Right,
so
like
I'd keep one or
two.
Months.
August, September?
Yeah, September.
Couple months, yeah, so.
And whoever's on it, honestly, you ought to stay because you're up to speed.
Yeah, no, I would do that. I'm just saying I could probably take something else also.
Yeah.
Awesome.
So does Mark and David want to stay on the library building committee?
Yeah. I don't mind.
Yeah.
I haven't been to the latest.
And then permanent building committee is a lot of fun. Yes, Caitlin can now attest.
Yeah.
She went last night.
Are you covering that?
So is one enough, actually?
So do we want to have two people? You're thinking?
I think so, because you know, right now it's one project, but there's going to be times when it's really stuff's going on. You may as well assign two now and then not need to go.
Right.
Does Eric have anything?
Not yet.
He's about to.
He's about to have permanent building committee.
I actually think that's a great fit for him. I think that actually would work quite well. Paula, do you want to continue on that one?
Sure. Unless we're looking.
Let's kind of finish the list here. Let's see. So we've got the community development, community services, and library left, and RMLD, sorry. Public
DPW?
Safety.
And
DPW finance.
Yeah.
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 The departments
public
aren't
safety,
that big
of a deal. Craig
yeah. Yeah. So RMLD is...
I'll continue on that. I don't
great.
Have a problem with that.
Oh, because a lot of the town services you actually get via selectmen.
Right. Yeah, the town departments is more meant in case something comes up. And
yeah.
FinCom needs to have a discussion with the department. And, David Greenfield used to come in and see the two chiefs probably more often than most FinCom people as the liaison. Aside from planning, but police details. You did
exactly.
Talk about
police details.
I knew you were
going to
say it. So. But it's not frequent that a liaison to a department has choose to do it if, for instance, they're in the middle of zoning, and there's going to be a lot of economic development, downtown zoning, parking discussion, so does that involve FinCom? I don't know. Probably not a bad idea.
I had community development, community services, but I was never invited to any meetings.
Well,
so
they don't, they're a department.
Are they that
yeah.
they're in
yeah.
that situation?
Yeah.
I'm
so
happy to keep them then. If something comes up, I can always attend. As long as they know I exist.
Yeah. How about the library?
I'll keep the library.
So that would give you schools, library, community development, community services.
Community development, community services don't really.
They're the same.
Okay.
Well, they're two parts of one department.
That's why I took them both on last year.
Yeah, and unfortunately, if you really wanna be notified, that's almost every volunteer that the selectmen appoint, most are in that department. Public health, zoning, CPDC, conservation, I mean, the list goes on.
So what would be the best way for me to know if something was happening with those?
You know, to me, FinCom's role in most of that stuff is zero. But where it is important is in probably the business section of the community. So, and maybe the 40B down by the depot has economic implications, but I don't know.
Maybe the thing to do is make a formal introduction to the department heads first, just kinda introduce yourself as the liaison.
Yeah, and maybe they can pick and choose. You know, CPDC occasionally is worth going to if they're gonna conceptually discuss an issue that would have financial. You know, for instance, CPDC and the selectmen are meetings, I can't remember, sometime in July. I guess they haven't set a date yet. I think they're leaning to the 18th. And then they're gonna invite chairs and vice chairs from most of the other boards in that department, so that would be a good meeting to go to.
Why don't you say that one was?
They haven't set a date yet, but I'll let you know.
I'll check the website and see who the heads are of those, introduce myself.
Yeah, Assistant Town Manager Jean Delios. I'll shoot her an email and copy you tomorrow.
Perfect, thanks. So yeah, I'll keep the library too.
Okay.
Was the finance liaison to you, Sharon?
The finance?
I would suggest that be Eric, because he already is that.
Excellent.
He's been talking to Sharon.
So I haven't done anything on that.
Good.
I'm on that, but I don't know what that is.
The finance?
Yeah.
We don't really have meetings. I think it's just in case something were to come up, correct?
Yes.
Okay, so you would reach out to.
I would reach out to both the liaison, yeah.
Great.
It sounds like Eric will already be there, so.
Yeah.
Yeah. Is there anything we didn't cover?
Public Works, DPW,
Public Safety.
I have DPW.
You've got selectmen and LBC.
Yeah.
But how long do you think LBC will continue?
3-4 months.
Okay. So you want to pick up?
I'm okay, yeah.
Great.
And public safety.
DPW.
Let's give it to Eric, who's not here.
So he.
Actually, that's good. He was part of that firearms discussion.
Yeah.
So
yep.
Yeah.
That's right.
Boy, he just fits right in.
We picked the right guy.
Yeah. He'll never miss another meeting, even though he's not technically legal yet.
Yeah, that's right.
I'm sure he's watching.
I'm sure he's watching. I can back that up.
You ought to give him regional schools.
Welcome to FinCom.
Well, has regional schools been anything?
They hardly talk to us anymore. They used to be an issue. They used to be a problem. They're not a problem anymore.
I think we have.
They are going to build a new school at some point, though, and that'll. It won't hurt Reading or impact Reading much, but it will be a big, big topic.
So I only have selectmen. I think the only one with one assignment so far.
I think you got enough to do.
Yeah, maybe that's all right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. We'll post for the 12th and 26th of July for the BOS meetings.
Yeah.
And whoever can attend, that would be great. And we get to a quorum.
20th.
12th of July, 26th for the Board of Selectmen meetings.
Oh, I see.
And then we will have a meeting ourselves July 20th. Or at least we'll hold that spot for now. And then also August 31st, we'll hold that spot. So my suggestion in terms of the last agenda item coming back to was the role of credit financial information to the community. Maybe that's something we defer to the next meeting more specifically and see where things are headed and what we can do. But again, I think what we need to do is kind of synthesize from what we heard, how are we gonna help get information available, which we cannot post on the website, is that true? We can post it if it's,
I think,
yeah, if it's.
There is, there's an override section under the assessors because that's where it made the most sense. And there's some basic running factual information, like the three presentations are up there, and I don't know, a couple of frequently asked questions.
they able to upload, or would it be different?
Tom, right now. But I don't know, it's an interesting question whether that belongs in a FinCom website or not. It clearly can, I mean, the assessors are the tax policy people, so
right.
that made sense. Whether it belongs in FinCom, I have to think about that. You know, from other towns, usually it's in the assessors or on the front page and kind of unaffiliated. Like there's just a standalone link that says override.
Can you put it multiple places then?
Yeah. We'd rather have it in one place, but it could be referenced from many areas, I guess is the best way to say it. When I say we, I mean.
Yeah.
I have no idea how to do any of that anymore.
Yeah. Gotta go for the youth.
Yeah.
Any other business for tonight before the 23rd? A
couple of things on RMLD.
Oh, please.
I haven't gone to those meetings. And they asked me to bring up a couple of things. So.
Good.
First one is possible solar panels on high school roof. I didn't know how much discussion there was. But
that's a very sore topic.
Yeah, I kind of remember that, but they wanted me to push it again.
Don't.
On the roof or the parking lot? I thought it was the parking lot.
Let's just say that, and I'll say this publicly, the RMLD has been a pest on this,
yeah.
and they have not cooperated with the town at all, and so we've washed our hands with them for now.
Well, they're willing to pay rent, but not going to be a budget customer right now.
Now, when they want to come back and actually have an engaging conversation, we're willing to have it, but they've been very difficult to work with.
Okay.
I have no problem saying that.
The other thing I was supposed to push is more on a personal than a finance committee level, and that's the use of time of use metering for the house. Basically, you get two different electrical rates, one between 7 p.m. and 12 noon, and then another between 12 noon and 7. And the 12 to 7 is the peak time for electrical usage, and so you pay a higher rate for that. But it can save, well, if you schedule your electricity usage, and then also it'll save RMLD and it'll save you individually. And they said, people see 15% to 20% savings on their electrical bill by work with that. And I actually had to put
so
in.
So avoid new
avoid
7
peak.
In the evening?
Right. Well, it's a big air conditioning time.
Yeah, not being at home, so good.
Yeah, not
good
being at home,
yeah.
yeah. and it also, all the weekends are lower rate and holidays as well. So it's, I think it's the transmission rate is 13 for peak, 13 cents per kilowatt hour, and 5 cents per kilowatt hour off peak. So I don't know what I'm saving, but I actually did have the meter put in about 2 weeks ago, I think. So I haven't gotten the bill yet.
So what does it do? It actually?
It registers, if you're using it between 12 and 7, it counts it on one side of the meter, and it counts it on the other side of the meter for the other time.
Okay.
Is the new meters that they recently put in?
No, you have to ask for it. Yeah, it's voluntary only. And if you do volunteer, you have to commit for at least 1 year.
1 year.
But it was 5 minutes, and you then have to reset.
So you have
box.
To have that specific meter for them to
in
get
order
those
to do
rates.
It. Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah.
They send some mails. I think I read
been
about
trying,
it.
They trying to push it, but I don't. Like I said, I don't know what we're saving yet, but later on, like thermostats.
We'll expect you to report back the next
week. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
That's the RMLD report.
For air conditioning.
Well, what I did was I set it for lower in the morning and then shut off it or go to a higher temperature starting at noontime so that it'll coast for the rest of the day, hopefully. It's been coming on about 6 o'clock at night, so I don't know. Some days it'll shut off, some days it'll.
Any other business?
Minutes.
Let's review the minutes. Sorry. Last pages. So these are the motions mainly for the budget.
My glass away.
Motion to accept the minutes.
Second. else, guys? I would entertain a motion.
Motion to adjourn.
Wait a second.
Second.
All those in favor? We are 8-0-0. We are adjourned.
Goodbye, Craig.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
Goodbye, Craig.
Yeah. Yeah.
Which one?
I was supposed to write for you.
Oh, yeah, I know. Oh, boy.
My God.
You all sit down and go. The RCTV started the Reading Post, the new online newspaper. So Phil from RCTV wanted me to make sure that I got a good picture of you guys.
Cool.
Yeah,
that's good. The glint may be hard, but you get a picture.
Thank you very much.
All the Reds are together.
Yeah. Everyone look busy.
Yeah, really.
Do you want us to gather closer? Does this work?
No, this is fine.
Oh.
Okay, thank you guys very much.
Thank you.
The beginning.
That was Rob, by the way. Thanks, Rob.
Yeah.
I'm impressed you put your back on.
Yeah.